Oh boy. Do you want us to take these blankets off, by the way?
I'm
It
cool if
does
you're
look a little
cool.
funny, doesn't it? These
No, I'm kind
blankets.
of cool with them, but we can take them
Okay.
off if you want. If you think they should go,
No, it's
no,
I don't
okay.
care. It's just 'cause the air conditioning is so cold in here that as people are watching movies, they wrap themselves up.
Kind of like the. It looks comfy.
Yes.
Comfy combined
Well,
with
this
dewy.
is his temple of worship, you know. This is where he looks at mainly great films of the past and relishes them and teaches us all about them, and
And
particularly his daughter, yeah.
always in 35, or is he is he succumbed to DVD in this room?
Oh, yes, we do. And we can run DCPs, digital cinema
Yeah.
packages too. So, but it's really, I mean, it really is his temple of
So
worship.
what's the best movie you've seen in here?
With him?
Yeah, that
Oh
wasn't one
my
of
God.
yours.
Oh, there are so many. I don't know. I've seen so many with him. We just saw on New Year's Eve, we saw Sunset Boulevard, the restoration of Sunset Boulevard, which is quite a stunning movie about
Yes. So
Hollywood.
do you, I mean, we were actually had the conversation the other day about my take was actually started with now see, I'm brain damaged with Preston Sturges.
Oh,
I kind of
yes.
feel like the movie went from this movie goes from Preston Sturges into Billy Wilder into Marty Scorsese. It feels like the evolution to me, but does it feel that way? Do you feel Wilder is a big influence here?
Don't know if I think Wilder's. I mean, I'm not as much of a student of Wilder as Scorsese is, but I maybe yes, maybe there's certainly, you know, Double Indemnity is just
Yeah.
even up to 1, 2, 3, the movie that Cagney made about the Cold War, which is one of our favorites. Yes, but probably there's no doubt a touch of it. I don't think of it that way, but I know the other great influences on him are so profound, you know, that I do sometimes see the influence. And the wonderful thing about it is that he takes the influence and translates it into something his own. He doesn't mimic it. You know, there are movies that have been made that mimic Hitchcock, but Marty never does that. He takes the inspiration and he makes it his own somehow, which is great.
Does he verbalize it? Do you guys have conversations about
Yeah, there are times when
reference
he
points?
will actually show me or the crew a shot that he's been influenced by. And he often screens heavily for the crew before many films that he feels are relevant to the subject. For example, of course, on Hugo, the crew got a huge education in film history, and they run a lot of films, and it's wonderful. I mean, they love it. Their minds are opened, and they understand the inspiration and how it's affecting him and the shots he designs. So,
So when do you have, when did you have your first conversation with him about Wolf?
I don't remember, but we didn't actually talk about it too much. And what was surprising for all of us was that it turned out to be a black comedy. Everybody thought it was going to be relatively serious or something. And the crew kept saying to me, "Gosh, you know, we're laughing so much on the set." And when I first saw the dailies, I couldn't believe the humor, because the humor is coming out of their callous behavior. And the actors were so willing to fit into these parts of these men doing terrible things. And that's how the humor evolved. And they were very fearless about it, particularly Leo, I think you can see, is absolutely fearless in this movie about what he does. And so I was seeing this tremendous comedy coming out of not only the screenplay, but how the actors then improvised on it. I was roaring with laughter in my editing room, and so much so sometimes that the assistants would come in and say, "Are you all right? What's what's going on?" Because sometimes when you work on a comedy, the editing of the comedy is what makes the humor. But here, the dailies were so funny, I couldn't believe it. And they just kept going off on riffs, you know. I mean, somebody would come up with an idea and they would just go off on it. And it was great. For example, the wonderful actor Kenneth Choi, who is in the deposition with the Securities and Exchange Commission, and he Marty told the actors they could come up with ideas for themselves in that. He wanted it all to be shot in one angle so that the different heights of each of the brokers would pop up and down when we did straight cuts. So some of them are very tall and the camera's cutting them here. Some of them are very short. And so Kenneth Joy's idea was to stuff his mouth with donuts. Marty had no idea what he was going to do. He just saw that the prop man had brought in three donuts. And so Kenneth just improvised that whole thing. Oh. And the whole 20-minute take is a riot. I wish we could have used it all.
It seems like there was a lot of that in this movie, where there was a lot of longer versions of scenes that we otherwise love or like want to see the rest of it.
I know, that's right. It's the improvs are just, we had to drop some really great stuff, but you have to make a film have a flow. And we have done it in a lot of our movies, and after Hours we dropped 45 minutes of wonderful improvised cut scenes because the film just couldn't handle it. But they were so great that I finally convinced Marty to put them on as extras on the DVD that came out some years ago.
A Scorsese rarity. He doesn't really...
I know, because he doesn't believe in that.
Yeah.
But it was his favorite scene, my favorite scene, and the actors were just so wonderful. So we did, I don't know if that will happen here, but we did have to drop a lot of great stuff, yeah.
So in the beginning of something like this, I mean, are you just conscious of what he's thinking about doing? Are you having conversations just kind of as friends and colleagues before he decides what he's going to actually shoot?
Not before so much. I don't talk with him before it, but when we're in dailies together, that's a very important time for me because he talks to me constantly about what he's seeing, and he still reacts like an audience. You know, it's great. And he'll say, well, you know, this actor is getting close to what I want. Maybe in take six it'll be there. I'm not sure, it's not quite here yet, but I like the first part of that and maybe the second part of this. So he's constantly reacting to the footage, and from that I take careful notes and I talk to him about what I feel, and then from that I start the first cut. Then when he's through shooting, he comes in and we edit the rest of it together intensely. It's a very intense collaboration.
So wonderful. You just say, Thelma, get ready. We're going to work. Be there and be ready for dailies.
Oh well, dailies are always scheduled after the shooting day. You know,
right.
So it changes every day. I never, you know, we keep getting updates. Oh, they're going over an hour, so it'll be later. And
but how does he tell you to get into the bat suit and, you know, get ready to go? We're going to start shooting on a certain date, and you're on from that point? And
yes, I come on the first day of shooting, right. I'm not needed before that. I come on the first day of shooting, and then I start cutting from there. But it's great being in dailies with him because, first of all, he's very brutal on himself. He's got very high standards, and he's very, you know, tough when he looks at his own footage. And so, but it's in a tremendously enjoyable time because he's never forgotten how to react to film as an audience, which is very important for a director, I think. Mm-hmm. And sometimes, well, the actors told me on this film particularly that hearing him laugh during the take was such a great thing for them. Mm-hmm. I know Margot Robbie, the wonderful Australian actress who does a Long Island accent so perfectly, she said that sometimes she wondered if she was improvising, was she going a little too far, and then she would hear Marty laughing off camera, and she would say, oh, I guess it's okay. Mm-hmm. And the sound man was very concerned to me. He said, you know, he's laughing an awful lot in this movie. It's going to be a problem for you. But it turned out not to be. But I know all the actors have told me when they hear Marty laugh while they're doing their improvs, they just love that. Yeah.
Mm. So where did you start? I mean, what was that first cut when he finally was done with the picture and you did an assembly? How long is your first assembly on something like this?
We don't screen the first assembly. I cut sometimes two or three versions of each scene. So we work together piece by piece, starting at the first scene and working away to the end. There is no first. Our first cut was 4 hours. Yeah.
Because that's a suicide leap usually for directors when they see it all assembled. I guess you skip that part of it.
Well, that's true. I think a lot of directors have told me that the first assembly is very depressing.
Yeah.
So we avoid that step. So we you know, we shape it together, and then we screen. Yeah.
So do you go from beginning to end, or you go in order?
Sometimes there have been films where we wanted to start in the middle or something for some particular reason. Maybe mm-hmm. there might, we hardly ever reshoot, but sometimes he may want, he may think he doesn't have enough on something and he may have to reshoot something. So we'll start on that first. But usually it's best to start at the beginning because you want to feel the film emerge, you know, mm-hmm. and change its shape and begin to tell you things. So you want to start at the beginning, yeah.
So what is that like? I mean, you really are discovering as you get into the beginning of the second act that you're making a different movie than you thought you were making when you started cutting?
Definitely. The reason I don't read the script but once, if I can, mm-hmm. I put it away because I like to see it emerge on the film, emerge on the screen in dailies, mm-hmm. and then as we're editing and working on it. Oh yeah, a film tells you what it's going to be like, and you have to understand that and sometimes change your mind about what you're doing with it.
Hmm. So are you, do you have significant changes in what you're thinking you're doing?
I don't, well, Marty,
I mean, how much is that line between Marty and you in terms of that? Or are you just right. So together and doing it that it
Well, yeah, I mean, our partnership is so old and, you know, we've been working together half a century.
Oh, Lord.
So it's pretty scary when he said that to me the other day. But we're like one mind, really. However, he does rely on me to have a little more of perspective on it. He's been dreaming of it, collaborating on the writing, shooting it for a long time. And he likes a cold eye to look at it and tell him if certain things are happening that he's not aware of. So it's but we do work just hand in hand. He taught me everything I ever know about editing. So my taste is really his taste, you know. But it's a great just back and forth constantly all day long. We make 1,000 decisions every day. Mm-hmm. And the thing that was different here was that he had designed some wonderful sequences. He wanted the film to be a ferocious rush. And so he had designed beautiful sequences in the opening, for example. Every shot is planned to go to every shot mm-hmm. until we hit the big scene with Matthew McConaughey in the lunch, which is so brilliant, beautifully written screenplay, and then improvised on by both guys beautifully. So we rushed up to that, and then the film stops for, you know, 4.5 minutes. Well, that beautiful. And then we pick up the rushing end. So that was a structure that I wasn't used to. And we had to find ways to balance it all out.
He said that when that section happened, when he was on set and that moment was happening, that's when he kind of knew that the film was going to work, and that, you know, he kind of had an idea of what it was really all about for him. Is that
Yes, it was one of the first scenes that I saw, and I could not believe how funny it was. And also what happened, which was great, was that Matthew McConaughey warms himself up before takes by doing that chant that you hear. And after a couple of takes, Leo and Marty looked at each other and they said, let's put it in the scene. And of course, that just, I mean, what a wonderful way to start, with Leo looking absolutely awkward in the middle of this, you know, it's supposed to be the top of the World Trade Center that is no longer with us, and this man is chanting and Leo is looking. So it's a wonderful way to start the scene. And then, of course, end the scene. And then Leo and Marty decided later on, when he does his farewell speech and then decides he's not going to leave, why don't we reprise that? And then, of course, all the brokers got into it, and it was great. I mean, these things just happen. Marty loves accident when it happens on the set. Mm. He loves to capitalize on it, and always has. Strange things, you know, you're talking to me was just an accident. I mean, Bob was really asking him that, are you talking to me, in Taxi Driver? And then they decided to develop it.
Well, so that scene, the McConaughey sequence, was originally 8 minutes, I guess, or something like that, I guess?
No, I don't think it was ever that long. It was only about 5. I mean, almost everything is in there. It's so good that almost everything is in there. There are a few little side things that he said that we didn't need, but maybe it was 5, and now it's 4.5 or something. You know, we didn't take much out.
So do you have darlings that you have to kill all the time? Is that part of your...
Oh, yeah.
It's agony of doing something like that?
It's very hard when you have a film where you have to drop whole scenes, and it is like cutting off your leg, I'm telling you. It's just the worst thing. That wasn't the case here. We were able to shave things down very carefully. I never thought we'd get an hour out of it, but we did. And but in other films I've worked on, we've had to drop, you know, as I said, my favorite scene in After Hours, Marty's favorite scene. And but you have to. That's part of your job as an editor, is to make sure the film has a good dramatic structure, isn't too long, and has flow. Mm. And if the script is overwritten, then you have to cut it out. It's hard.
Is it exciting to get to make those cuts and actually have it work when you were so sure that it was should have been longer? Or?
What's great is when you screen the film and it finally everything is starting to click. Everything is the right length. Everything is flowing. There's a current flowing through it, because editing is really somewhat like plumbing. You take two things and you put them together, and if you do it right, electricity flows through or water flows through. Mm-hmm. In other words, it's the combination of the images or how you cut the dialogue together that gives you the thrill that you need when you're looking at a movie as an audience. So as we cut, we usually screen 12 times, which is a lot. Most editors don't get the luxury of that. Mm-hmm. And as we're screening, the film is getting tighter and tighter, and there'll be parts of it that are getting the flow, and then there'll be parts of it that are still too slow. So gradually you keep working towards it, and then finally there's a screening where it just clicks and you know you've done it. I tell my students when I talk to them that it's like someone on a diet and there's a dress you're trying to get into for some event, and you know, slowly you're slimming down, and suddenly that dress just fits perfectly. That's what it's like. Yeah.
So how much of that is that feel in the room and knowing the audience is there, and how much of it is it the two of you looking at each other and going, we got it?
You absolutely need to screen to feel the film correctly, because it can just take one person in the room and suddenly you're seeing it through their eyes. And of course, when you have a whole room full of people, it's fantastic, because particularly with this film, to hear the laughs was just so great. And Marty is always, I'm always very nervous about showing the film to people because it's not ready yet, but we need that. That's one of our tools in editing, is to screen. So when I say, well, now who shall we invite to this screening? He'll say, invite the janitor, bring the janitor in, sure, just bring anybody. And but I'm telling you, if the janitor was in the room, we would, even if it was just the janitor, we would learn a lot from him, you know. And you also learn from, well, of course, the laughs. Why didn't we get a laugh there? We should have gotten a laugh there. We recut to get that laugh. Mm-hmm. Or when people are getting restless, you see them move. And it's interesting, almost the whole room will start to move at a certain point if something's too long or isn't working. And so it's extremely important to screen, and editors are not given enough screenings, I don't think, you know.
Well, I guess everybody's scared now that they're going to be reviewed somehow in a screening.
I guess so.
The system, the world has changed, unfortunately.
Really? Yeah. You mean blogging and stuff?
Yeah. Well, the test screenings, that became kind of 15 years ago when Ain't It Cool News kind of broke out. It was test screening reviews that were kind of making everybody insane.
We hate those, of course, because the film isn't ready. Maybe the score isn't in. It's not mixed the way it's going to be. So it's but you do learn a tremendous amount. And on Departed, they said, we're going to Chicago. We said, oh, God, Chicago. Why are we going to Chicago? So we went, and I saw the audience coming in, and I said, this looks like our audience. And then we had the most incredible screening. They were so with that movie. And there was one wonderful woman who was reacting very strongly to certain things. And when Leo got shot in that movie particularly, she got very upset. And then when Matt Damon got shot at the end, she said, that's what I'm talking about. And it was the most amazing screening. We just felt the film come alive, and we were dreading it, you know. So you never know. We've had bad ones. We've had great ones.
Do you learn more from the bad ones than the good ones?
Sorry?
Do you learn more from the bad ones than the good ones? Or?
No, the really worst one we had was Age of Innocence, and it was in a factory town in New Jersey. Right. Not our audience for a film about, the elegant Gilded Age of New York. Mm-hmm. And so I saw the people coming in, and I said, oh, my God, this is not our audience. And sure enough, there was one woman in the audience who sided with Winona Ryder, who was playing the wife. Michelle Pfeiffer is playing the great love of Daniel Day-Lewis. Mm-hmm. And we thought the audience would be siding with her and Daniel, and their desire to be free for their love. But she sided with Winona, who is great in the movie, by the way. And she started to laugh at the movie, and then other people started to laugh, and then other people started to laugh. Mm. It was hell, I can't tell you. And Marty and I were dying, and we looked back at Elmer Bernstein, who had been in the business 50 years. He composed films for Cecil B. DeMille. Mm. And a great composer, and he had his head in his hands. So we thought, But the studio was great. It was Mark Canton, and he said, look, this is the wrong audience. Go back and work on it again and forget this. And it was great. And people love the film now.
Once a room goes the wrong way, though, it can get...
Oh, it's terrible. It's terrible.
It's the Chuck Oldest Clown episode.
It hasn't happened to us in a long time, but that was brutal. I must say, that was very painful.
Is there a degree of relief cutting a comedy, or what turned out to be a comedy?
Well, it was, after hours when we were cutting it, Marty and I worked on it for a long time before anybody saw it, and we didn't even know whether we were going to get the laughs. But on this movie, I knew we were going to get the laughs because I was laughing, and even in our very small screenings in this room with people, the agents and people who know and have worked on the film very hard, they were roaring. So I wasn't so anxious on this one. I knew it was incredibly funny in a very unique way, a new way. It was great. Yeah.
So what do you know about actors from being an editor that everybody else doesn't know? I mean, obviously you know where all the bodies are buried, but you know when they mess up, but.
Well, I mean, part of an actor's, so let me start that again. Part of an editor's job is to make sure an actor's performance is properly put together so that it works on the screen. I've learned everything I know about acting from Marty. He's had a gut instinct about acting from the time he came out of the womb. I swear to God. I don't know. He watched a lot of great movies on television on that wonderful program, Million Dollar Movies, where he could see a film 7 times in 1 week and he studied it. But he told me one of the great things that he learned about acting is when he and his teenage friends were sitting in the Paramount in Brooklyn watching a movie and they would snicker at something they didn't believe. That taught him a great deal. So, he's very tough about what he will accept from an actor. He really wants the acting to come through the face, from the body, And he hates any devices that an actor might use, for example, eyebrows are one of his big things. He will not allow eyebrows to be moved, sometimes, but not usually, because he feels that's fake and that's a crutch. Let me put it that way. So he has an extraordinary attitude about acting that it has to be very truthful and believable. And he'll often say to me in dailies in one take, I don't believe that. I don't believe that. So, and I'm finding in movies recently that I've seen a lot of things I don't believe. I think people are sticking stuff out there and asking you to believe it, but they're not making you believe it. And Marty makes you feel it, which is why his films disturb people sometimes, I think, because they don't want to feel some things. For example, in Wolf, one of the things he's working is the fact that all of us are certainly attracted at times to wealth and quick wealth, particularly, and don't. We perhaps think of the consequences and reject it, but it's easy to be seduced by it, which is what he did in Goodfellas too, And Goodfellas was criticized the same way this movie's being criticized when it came out. And I don't think it's fair at all. I think he wants you to look at it and you to make up your mind about what these people are doing, the terrible things these people are doing. And if you don't get it when that girl's head is being shaved in the middle of the brokers having an orgy at the end of their month celebration, that is saying something very powerful. This is monstrous. And if the audience doesn't get that, I don't know what to say. I mean, that is very much of a judgment, but you have to make that judgment. He doesn't want to point fingers and make moralistic judgments because he doesn't think people listen to them. He wants you to see what that world is like, to immerse you in it and make you understand it, and then you make up your mind about it.
The thing that kept on striking me in that scene in particular was that it was only $10,000. And there was all that talk, Jordan talks about numbers through the whole thing. And they're so big, and then you realize compared to what anybody else in the room is making, she's shaving her head for less than they're making anyway.
Yeah. I couldn't believe that footage when I saw it. It was so powerful. And then when she's given the money, and there are tendrils that they haven't shaved off, and she gets up and walks away, and, you know, people are just having this mad orgy. My God, how powerful is that, you know?
And her ambivalence is also
yes,
in that moment.
Yes, that she's supposed to be, all throughout it, she's supposed to be enjoying it and part of it, but you can see...
Yeah,
it's terrible for her.
But she's also happy to have the money.
Yeah,
and that's the thing. It's like
Well, that's the whole point of the film, right? I mean, that is the point of the film. This is very seductive, and you better be very careful when you make a choice to enter that lifestyle. As Marty said to me in Goodfellas, if the little boy says, you know, they could always get up when he's watching them from the window, and he's still very young. He says they could always get a parking spot on the street because they were members of the mafia. And he said, if that's your idea of what you want out of life, you're in trouble. Mm. And that's what he's trying to show in this movie.
So do you make a connection between this and Goodfellas? I mean, it's an interesting conversation ongoingly with people about, you know, where this film fits in his oeuvre. And, you know, personally, I see it's coming from a completely different place than Goodfellas, really.
I don't see it at all as another Goodfellas, you know, and it disturbs me when I read that. I wish people would let go of that movie. You know, Marty and I
really
say we
good
should...
It's a movie. It's hard to let go of.
Marty and I say we should burn that movie because everybody's always trying to make us make it again, you know, and so at the end of our movies, they always say, you know, the last 20 minutes of Goodfellas, could you make the last 20 minutes of this movie like that? Well, you know, Shutter Island... and The Departed and a movie about the Dalai Lama, Kundun, they're not on coke. Mm-hmm. You know, the Dalai Lama is not on coke at the end of that movie. No. So you can't, we can't do that. So we keep saying, let's burn it. I mean, we're so tired of the comparison. And Roberto Rossellini, the great Italian director, made a movie called Paisa. There's a poster of it right out there. A great movie. And everybody wanted him to remake that movie for the rest of his life. It drove him nuts. So I don't buy the comparison between Goodfellas and this movie. I don't think it's valid. I really don't.
I think the last part of this movie is actually kind of the opposite in a way,
yes.
in that it's completely not a comedy anymore. The last 20 minutes or so seems like it just all the comedy's gone, and the audience is actually kind of leaning forward, wanting to laugh, and having a hard time not laughing, I think, in some ways. But
Exactly. I think the wrenching turn in this movie at the end is something people don't expect, but he wants you to feel the pain and feel that justice is finally being done, even though I think because Jordan Belfort testified against so many of the people who had devoted themselves to him, went to their trials and testified against them, is why he got such a little sentence from the court. And of course, this happens all the time in the American justice system, but that's pretty damning, I think. And people don't seem to be quite recognizing that, maybe. I don't know.
Well, I think they're so, the comedy is so strong and so intense that when it stops, I do think it's almost like they're sitting forward in their seats,
yes.
waiting to laugh again. And it's like all of a sudden they're, and I think the whole movie is like that in a way. I think it's like, for me, it's like three acts almost. Even though a little unevenly in terms of numbers, but that it goes from this kind of much broader place to a much more reality starts to set in at the same time. It's still broad and big, and then it's very real at the end and very tough. And, you know.
And it should be, you know, it should be, because you should realize what he's done to himself and to the world, you know. It's good that the film turns that way. It's unusual, and... that's why, you know, we're in the comedy category in the awards, which is very funny for me because I didn't think of the film as a comedy. I think it's valid to have different styles in a movie, but it's unusual and people, but Marty's movies are unusual and that's why they often don't get received immediately as well as they do over time because people have to encounter something new. They have to engage with the movie. That's what he wants. He wants you to engage with the movie. And some people would rather just go and sit and just have a good time, you know, but not engage. But with his movies, you have to. And that's good filmmaking as far as I'm concerned.
Well, you also have to let it breathe. I mean, I think the best filmmakers, you have to, you know, it's the second time you see it, it's the third time you see it. It starts to, you know, clarify itself. You get less, you're not as interested in Margot Robbie being naked as you are in... why she's naked and what it means.
Yes.
Changes the whole thing.
Yeah, and people keep wanting to see this movie over and over again, which is a great sign, I think. Mm-hmm. I mean, the first people who saw it, they wanted to see it the next day right away, and that was when it was 4 hours long. So that was a very good sign, yeah.
So can you, or do you, separate, in, at least in your mind, if not in public, your work from Marty's work? Or, I mean, in terms of when you're cutting together, or does it feel like the collaboration is the... is the thing.
Right. I mean, everybody's so interested in this subject, they want to make it clear that I'm a woman of power or something. I don't know.
Well, you are a woman of power, but I also, I mean, just in terms of somebody working, it sounds like it's such an intensive, you know, it sounds you're his best friend who happens to be an editor and,
well,
and you do it together.
It's an incredibly wonderful partnership and collaboration that's been going on for years, you know. And so we're like an old married couple in the editing room, you know. Mm. And we do have some minor disagreements usually, but usually we're both on the same page and we're going for what's best for the film. And so I know what I bring to it, and he knows what I bring to it. But it's nothing that I stress or need to... emphasize. I mean, it's just such a wonderful experience being in the room with him. You cannot imagine what it's like to be with a man with this incredible creative genius and fascinating mind. Mm. You know, he says he's not an intellectual, but he is, because he questions and analyzes constantly, and it's wonderful to be around that. And then we always have on the side of the room Turner Classic Movies running silent without the sound. And because our view is this way, but every once in a while we'll look over and see some fantastic thing and he'll say, wait a minute, there's this great shot coming up. Wait till you see what this director did. And so I'm also in the best film history class in the world. So he can be so funny, he can be moody. You know, it's an extraordinary experience being with him all the time.
Mm. And when the movie is now out there in the world, it sounds like you actually read some of the stuff that's being written about it or pay attention. Does it, do you care, or are you just interested? Are you a proud parent who kind of wants to know what people are saying? Or
I'm very interested in what people are saying, yeah. I know we've had such a long history of our films not being understood at first that that I've learned to adjust to that. I've learned to go with that, because many great films in the past have also suffered that way. My husband's films suffered that way. And I mean, The Red Shoes, when it first came out, the Rank organization thought it was a disaster and they wanted to kill it. Mm. And it became one of the most beloved films ever made. So I'm used to it. I think Marty would rather be on the cutting edge. And if people don't understand it right away, that's okay. It's better to be on the cutting edge than to be dull and conventional. He does not want to be conventional.
And when the phone rings the next time and he says, okay, it's time.
Of course. I mean, I basically only work for him, and I can't wait for the next one to start, which, by the way, is completely different from Wolf. Mm-hmm. And Hugo, our previous film, is completely different from Wolf. Now, how many editors get to work with a director that has that desire not to repeat himself? He's constantly setting himself a new challenge, and I get to go over the hurdle with him. And so many editors I know are bitter, and they get very little work, and they also sometimes work on films where they feel they could direct it better than the director. I always say to them, well, why don't you go try, because it's not as easy as you think. But I am working with someone who always makes these wonderful movies, and I get to edit them. I mean, it's the best job in the world.